Are you there, Brian?
We got him, y'all.
Hello, Brian.
Pinky.
Yes.
Flip the switch. Pinky, flip the flag. Flip the switch.
Meet flip the plug and plow the field and flow the blick and pluck the, yeah.
Oh, Lord, I can't believe this. Oh, this made my day. I have Pinky and the brain on right now. Welcome, everybody, to another Double Toasted interview. I am Corey Coleman, and you know, whenever we do these interviews, we don't do them for anybody. We're always having somebody special on, somebody that I'm close to their work, or I'm a big fan of the person. And before I introduce this person, let me just say this. Today, a lot of people, and this weekend, a lot of people are going to be celebrating the return of something very special to them. A lot of people are and have been eagerly awaiting the return of Animaniacs.
I've tried online dating, but I keep getting catfished. How do I know she's even real?
But you can't have the return of Animaniacs without the return of Pinky in the Brain. And I'm honored to have the brain himself right here, Mr. Maurice LaMarche. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you, my friend. When I take over the world, Corey, you shall be spared.
This is what I love about having, and this is what I love and hate about having these voice people over, because they do the voices and then I lose all professionalism when I get excited when they do it, man.
I'm glad to knock you off your professionalism.
You could at least give me like a couple of minutes, man, to be professional. You didn't have to come in and do that. But I love it. And I just got through telling Maurice, looking sexy with that turtleneck, man. Love a good turtleneck.
Thank you. I'm working on my Robert Wagner impression from the 60s. Beautiful. And I always get dressed up in costume whenever I do an impression. Actually, the truth of the matter is, I'm going to be honest, because I think I follow the Howard Stern dictum, honesty is everything in radio and broadcasting. I've had an outbreak of pimples on my neck like I'm 15 again. I don't know why. So I'm wearing a turtleneck to cover all that crap up.
Oh, going through your second teenager phase, man. That's nice. Yeah, that means you're young at heart.
62, and I'm having a second adolescence right now.
There you go, man.
Probably it's to do with the return of Animaniacs. It's making me feel like a kid.
Hey, man, so. 30 years later. Yeah. As long as you're getting them up here and not down there, you're good, man. I don't have to tell a lot of you people out there about how this man practically raised you in front of a screen as you watched many of the shows that he did, where he did the voice work. I mean, the only thing I feel like I'm doing bad here is that I can't just spend as much time talking about every one of these characters that you have done. Of course, you've done some things such as you've won Emmys. You won 2 Emmys for Futurama.
I did. I still don't know how the hell that happened. They're right up there in my office. I'll put the camera on them for 2 seconds. They're right up there in my office.
It's nice to win 2 of them for balance, man. You can like have them as bookends. Looks nice on the show.
What's fun though is that they're there, but the very center one is the one, that little loving cup is one my son gave me when he was 4. And it just says, "Happy birthday to my daddy." And he emphasized "my," like my daddy. And to me, that's the set front and center award. That's the most important award. Family trumps Emmys. Sorry, Academy of Television Arts and Sciences, but that's the way it goes.
Yeah. I don't think you're not made for LA, man. You're too nice of a guy.
Well, I feel like everybody in the cast should have gotten one before me. I mean, come on, Billy West, John DiMaggio, Katie Sagal. Their performances were so awesome during the run of the show, and I don't know how it landed on me, but I'm flattered and I'll take it, because you know, it messes with my low self-esteem. And anytime I can do that, it's a good thing.
Well, I'm sure all of those people you just named, they would say, you know what, just shut the hell up and take it. You earned it. You got that for a reason, which you did.
That is what they said when we came back the day after the Emmys. They said, shut the hell up and take it. Exactly those words. Very supportive friends.
Yeah, man. And no, you do the voice work community is incredible. You know, I've talked to some other people before, and it's just, and everybody's, it's like you, that they're so humble and they're so nice, man, and they're so appreciative.
Well, I think it's a function of the fact that I think we find the work, we go into that work maybe because we don't have as big egos. I don't know. I've still got me an ego. There's no question. But, you know, it's okay. The characters can be the stars. I'm glad. I'm glad to be a part of something like The Brain, with Pinky and the Brain. The fact that I get to be this character that people remember from their childhoods, that like, he's my child Brain. I mean, of all the characters I've done, Brain is the one that I feel like I birthed him. Even though I use an Orson Welles and a little bit of Vincent Price impression for him, he's from me. I hate to say, he's a lot of the bad things about me. I can be a bit of a controlling guy, especially like at home and especially in the kitchen. I've got like home megalomania. But he's got this warm spot for Pinky that he can't show. And that endears him to me so much, because he loves Pinky, and I love Rob Paulsen, and you know, but he just can't show it. And I think a lot of us are stuck in that with somebody in our lives. Anyway, I feel very lucky to be part of this and the fact that this is coming back after all this time and getting to play in that sandbox again is a blessing.
Yeah. I mean, how does it feel returning to that after 30 years? You say he was with you the whole time, but to come back into the voice again after 30 years, how is that?
Well, I think I sound more like Orson Welles now than I did when I was in my 40s. So voice has dropped a little bit in the past 27 years. So when you hear the show, which, you know, we're doing a Twitter watch party at 6 o'clock tonight. I don't have the hashtags for it, unfortunately, but I'm sure if you do a little search on Hulu, I think Hulu, if you follow Hulu and do our Twitter watch party, we're watching the first episode and we'll be commenting. You know, to get to play with these people again, and the scripts are just as good, a little edgier. It's a new creative team, and I love and miss the original creative team with all my heart. But the new creative team has stepped up to the challenge, and there's just a bit more of an edge because we're in a different era now. And especially Pinky and the Brain. 22 years have passed, and Brain has not taken over the world. He's a tad pissed about it, if you don't mind my saying so.
No, and I can tell. He was pissed back then when he couldn't take over the world. I can only imagine how he feels now.
He's a crankier Brain than your dad's Brain.
Oh, you should see the people in the chat talking about, I love this guy. You are my hero, Mr. LaMarche, people are saying.
Thank you.
You know, everyone knows the characters that I've listed off, that I've shown, that we've talked about in the short time that we've been on. But the amount of work that you've done is so impressively huge. You are one of those guys where you go back and look at things, you're like, oh, wait a minute, you did that?
I go back occasionally and look at my IMDb and go, wait a second, I did that?
Yeah.
It's all just been a function of showing up, doing my best that I can in audition and in performance, and not dying in the past, 35 years. You build up an IMDb listing like I have. And by the way, I don't have the longest one. Rob Paulsen's is longer than mine. I just felt very, very dirty saying that. I'm sorry.
And I thought it, but I didn't say anything.
Yeah, I know. Frank Welker, I think, has the second longest IMDb listing. Mel Blanc has the longest. Mel Blanc overtook him from the grave because somebody really devoted to Mel Blanc dug up every single thing he did and posted it on IMDb. Yeah. But there was a time for a very long time that Frank Welker had the longest IMDb listing of any actor or any performer, anybody in the internet movie database. I suddenly became William Shatner.
And I think William Shatner also wore that outfit that you have right now one time.
It's very 60s, isn't it?
Yeah, no,
I'll show you my outbreak.
No, I love the mid-century modern cool, man.
Thank you, baby.
And the attitude to go with it. You know, one of the things I was going to mention that I saw that I looked at, it's like, wow, you even a part of that. I don't know how many people remember this movie from back in the 80s, but it was one of my favorite movies as far as being an underground classic, cult classic film, Rock and Rule.
Rock and hot music, the best of times.
And Maurice LaMarche, you know, I want to put the character that you were in there because, I love this movie, man. I know it's a crazy movie. I can't even say it's great, but I love it. You are the voice of a character that actually... it's one of my favorite lines in the movie just because of the way you said it. You played the sailor. And I have to say, you have one of the, as far as last lines go for a death scene, you had that. I'm going to play that. You played a guy who was like an informant for the villains. And something you did to piss them off made them turn around and kill you. And you had a great departing line.
They're looking for your little sister. Oh, now we're even, right? Get off my back. Oh, shit.
I have to say, that is my favorite oh shit ever in any kind of movie, man.
I gotta tell you, I think I was 22 maybe when I recorded that. I still could do a French Canadian accent with some authenticity because I just crossed over the border and moved here, but I'd forgotten that I did him with a French Canadian accent. That's funny. Oh, my God. That's one of the very first jobs I ever did. Nelvana was the very first company to put me in anything animated. And they did it with something called Easter Fever, where we roast the Easter Bunny, played by Morris. And I played Don Rickles and Steve Martin as a rattlesnake and a horse.
And, what? 22 at the time, so that was an amazing piece of voice work to do at 22. Can you do the French Canadian accent now?
Well, now I do it a little deeper. There, I do an imitation of mon oncle. Many of my uncles, my father, lose his French Canadian accent when he went into broadcasting there. Eh? For a little while, my dad was on the television in Ottawa and Timmins, Ontario. He do the news, the weather, the sport. But his brother all talk like this. And my father did this superfluous Canadian sort of sophisticated. He and Alex Trebek actually worked together. In Ottawa, great Alex Trebek. They shared a makeup chair, and my father would do the news, weather and sports at 6:30 in French on the French channel. But Peter Jennings and Alex Trebek would do the news, weather and sports on the English channel from 6 to 6:30. Oh. So, yeah, my dad decided it wasn't for him though. After that, he didn't stick with it. But Jennings, Trebek. Whatever happened to those guys? No, I'm kidding, man. God bless them. They were amazing broadcasters.
Did you ever meet Alex Trebek yourself or Peter Jennings?
A couple times. And I'm friends with his daughter, Nikki. But I did meet Alex once in line at a restaurant. And it was just kind of cool because I dropped my father's name and he did remember him. He was always a gentleman. And I would send, after I got to know Nikki, I would just send messages back to tell Alex that Guy's son says hello. And I know Alex had nothing to do with the questions and answers of the research on the show, but I was an answer and not just the character of Brain. my name, Maurice LaMarche, because he would say it with a proper French-Canadian intonation. He would like draw out of English and into French because he was bilingual. And he, whenever my name came up as an answer on Jeopardy, it was such a thrill to me that I knew I'd arrived in show business when I became an answer on Jeopardy.
At what point did you realize that you're no longer just a voice actor? You are a celebrity. You know, you're a name now. Was it the Jeopardy moment?
I was kidding about arriving in show business. It's like one of those little funny, you know, humorous pats on the back. I don't ever think of myself as a celebrity. I'm stunned when anybody recognizes me, you know, on the street. To me, a celebrity is somebody who can't eat their dinner in peace because people are coming up. I went out for dinner with John Lovitz when we started doing The Critic for the first time. And we went to this little Lebanese restaurant and we're just trying to get through our meal. It's just him and me. We just recorded The Critic, like about our third episode. And this guy comes up with his kids and has the kids ask for the autograph. And he goes, are they old enough to know the show? You know, oh yeah, I make them watch it all the time. And then, you know, then they just kind of come back and stare at him. And then another young couple comes up and asks for the autograph. And it's hard for us to get through our dinner. And at the end of the dinner, John turns to me and goes, well, Maurice, that's what it's like to be famous. Are you sure you want it? And you know what? It really was a lesson to me. It's like, you know what? I'll be okay if I just make a decent living and can eat my dinner in peace. And I describe myself as having won the lottery on the 26 annual payments, you know, instead of the big lump sum. I've had a long, I'm very grateful for it, a very long career, making a very nice living year to year to year to year. And it adds up to a lottery win. So let me just keep doing that.
No, you
another 40 years and then I can retire at 102.
Hey man, that, you know what? That would be a great living if you were to make it that far. You truly have won because you've won now. I mean, I love when people say that because I think that you're right. Being able to do a voice work like this and reap the benefits of success without having to, you know, deal with what you just said. You know, people hounding you and whatnot. I've always found that that is an excellent way to live life, man. You're very fortunate.
And by the way, I'm always flattered if anybody ever recognizes me. And when we do the Comic Cons, it's very touching to find out how our work has affected people. And every time Rob and I do a Comic Con, we get stories of people who watching Animaniacs got them through, you know, their cancer treatments or got them through. I remember the first time it happened, a young lady came over and said, my mother died of cancer. And my father and I walked around for about a year completely in just shock. But every day at 4:30, we sat down and watched Pinky and the Brain. And that was our time to laugh. And we'd sit on the couch and just laugh and enjoy the show and then go back to kind of cooking in silence and eating in silence. But that was our oasis. And a story like that comes to me every time I do an appearance. So while I don't pretend that I am this altruist who started out to make this, you know, this wonderful project that would relieve pain, I mean, that is the function of all entertainment. We're in the business of helping you forget your problems, and that's what it is for me. I'm a consumer of entertainment. But, you know, I also know, hey, you know, you were just an actor trying to make your rent when you made those cartoons. It doesn't matter. The net effect, along with the 87, you know, animators and writers and producers and cell wipers and, you know, the whole staff that makes the show, the net effect was one of it helps people. And I feel honored to have been a part of it, even if I'm, you know, not the Dalai Lama of cartoons. You know, I'm glad to have been a part of it.
You know, your first voice acting gig, I believe, was in 1983. Now, correct me if I'm wrong. At the time, you were doing Inspector Gadget. And I got a little bit of a... of an example of that right here.
I suspect could be our arch nemesis, Dr. Claw, using a clever alias.
That was from Gadget and the Gadgetinis.
They were the little junior robots that were based on Gadget. They were just a little smarter than him. But they still managed to get into trouble. I play all three. I play Gadget and the two Gadgetinis, Fidget and Digit. And that was an interesting project because Don Adams had retired, and he with his blessing. In fact, he even said, "Get Mo to do me. He does me better than I do." I'd done the original series with Don, and it was the first U.S. gig I ever had. The rock and roll and the two half-hour network specials that Nelvana had done out of Toronto were my earliest work. And that the first TV specials I did while I was still living there. But when I got here, it took me a little while to get up and running with the animation thing. I was doing stand-up, and that was paying the bills.
Mm-hmm.
I actually thought, well, I the one inroad I had to animation is back in Canada, and I've left Canada, so I guess that's going to be it. And then I got in on a few things with Deke Entertainment. I've done The Littles and something called Wolf Rock TV, where I actually got to work with Wolfman Jack, the real Wolfman Jack.
Yeah.
And then Gadget came along, and I got to play Henchman Number One and the Chief, Chief Quimby. So I did 26 episodes alongside Don, and I really got to not only get friendly with him, but I also got to kind of really take him in as a subject of doing an impression of him. Because when you played that back for me just now, even I kind of went, "Hey, that's pretty good." You know, and I don't mean that to sound egotistical, but because I'm hard on myself, but I also give myself credit when I do something right. And that Gadget was, well, that was kind of cool. I almost thought it was Don for a second.
No.
So you don't need to compliment me. I'll just compliment myself, Corey. It's okay.
Are you there, Brian?
We got him, y'all.
Hello, Brian.
Pinky.
Yes.
Flip the switch. Pinky, flip. Flick the flag, flick the switch,
flick the flag and plow the field and flow the blick and pluck the, yeah.
Big box. Baby pig pop.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Hello, Brian.
Oh.
Tick sucking company.
Oh, my. Oh, my.
The baby buggy bumpers. Hey, Dad, toy boat, unique New York.
Oh, Lord, I can't believe this. Oh, this made my day. I have Pinky and the Brain on right now. This is an incredible moment for me, y'all. I am so happy to be here with these two.
Brain, look, Corey's lowered his journalistic standards for both you and me.
I trust you at least pulled over while you drink, Pinky.
Oh, are you driving, Brain? Because I recall, you don't so much drive as aim as you've gotten older.
Yes.
The chat is going crazy right now. I'm going crazy. This
tube to start the car, or are you all right now? Is that over with?
Me? Oh yeah, I am. I finally see what am I doing? I'm actually in San Simeon in my car outside a paint store because I'm working on our little vacation place, and very excited about the fact that Corey has allowed you and subsequently yours truly to regale the audience about what's happening tomorrow. Boy.
What are we doing tomorrow, Pinky?
The same thing we do once every 25 years. Launch Pinky and the Brain again!
No.
Yes!
Oh, this is an incredible moment for the people out there, but especially for me. I was on it before, but I cannot believe that this is happening right now. You two, thank you so much for doing this. This is a gift, is what it is. You know, this is incredible what you two are doing, because I read how a while back, Rob, how when you were in chemotherapy, Maurice came to visit you at that time.
Yeah, he didn't just come to visit me, Corey. Mo improved my life. And he does anyway, because of just the kind of man he is. Look, there are a lot of really talented people in Hollywood. It's not a big deal. What is a big deal is having people whose, you know, undeniable, provable, demonstrable, prodigious skill is eclipsed utterly by their heart and their humanity. And I'm telling you, That young man on the other end of this Skype call is way more than a dear friend. He really is. He truly is. I love Maurice LaMarche. Who doesn't? But when you get a chance to have him in your life like this, it's a really big deal, Corey. I'm so glad you brought that up.
No, I'm almost moved to tears by that. You know, I got to say, and you just got on, Rob, so I don't want to bring things down here, but you know, you both have suffered tragedies. Just like some things about you, Rob, and what you've done in the past, Maurice, you know, you had a career going before you did voice work. You were doing comedy, and it's funny because some of the comedy clips that I have right here that I found, they were almost showing that you were destined to do voice work at one time. This is a special. This is a special you did with where Rodney Dangerfield brought you on, and you just went into immediately doing these rapid fire impressions.
People ask me, how did you get started doing impressions? A lot of television when I was a kid.
Natasha, we must get Moose and Squirrel.
For a fuck-a-tash. Come along, Chumley.
G Tennessee.
You know, I look at that and
isn't that something?
That's amazing. And you know, I look
that
at
that is.
And so at the time, we already talked about how, you know, some of your first voice acting gigs and whatnot. At the time, were you even thinking that voice work would be a thing, or was comedy always the plan?
Well, comedy was the original plan, but voice work began making its way in there. I was doing, I was already doing Gadget around the time that the young comedian, that's from the 9th annual Young Comedian special. So I'd already done a couple of things. I think I was starting on Gadget or would be starting on Gadget soon. And it was always something that you know, Frank Welker was a friend before Gadget. We all hung out in the same little clatch of friends. Howie Mandel had, you know, kind of brought him into our little group. So Frank knew me for about a year before I got my first job. And Rob will attest to this. Frank Welker is one of the only people who will recommend other actors for a job
yeah.
already gone to him for. And he'll say, no. You know what? You want Rob Paulsen for that. He does that much better than me. He'll give up the job
so that
somebody else who's better will do it. He's got such confidence that, you know, and he knows how good he is, and he knows that there's enough work to go around and the right job will come around to him. So, you know, he'd been talking me up for a year at that point to casting directors like Ginny McSwain and Marsha Goodman and Andrea Romano. And, you know, I'd finally get jobs and they'd say, oh, you're the guy Frank Welker's been telling us about. So that was my intro.
Frank's like that. He's just he's kind of the best of us. And we've always kind of looked up to Frank as how to behave when you're a grown-up cartoon person. That's a bit of an oxymoron, yeah. But you see our point.
And we're lucky. We're so glad he's back on Animaniacs. I mean, he's
yes. Yeah.
Frank Welker. You know, a lot of we have a young audience, and I don't know if a lot of people are familiar with Frank Welker, but
Megatron.
Yep,
baby, he's Megatron. Right now he's doing the voice of Curious George on the show for PBS.
And he's doing,
you look him up on IMDb, and it looks like the Manhattan phone book. It's crazy.
Yeah.
He's Garfield now after Lorenzo Music passed. He's, right. He's not the voice of Garfield.
He was Slimer on Ghostbusters with
Scooby-Doo. So, I put a picture up there. And, you know, with the way you're talking about Frank Welker, the way you guys are talking about each other, is this normally how the voice work community is? Is it this supportive all the way around?
I think so. I think, you know, I kind of started to answer that issue a little bit earlier. I just think that we've got a little less ego, I guess, because our faces aren't involved.
Yeah.
You know, it's just about the work, and, you know, we're not trying to get in, you know, make sure we stay in the key light or any of that stuff. We're just really honoring the work, and we know it's, you know, if I don't get it, I hope Rob Paulsen gets the job.
Right.
Or I hope D. Bradley Baker gets the job. We see each other at auditions. You know, my wife used to do daytime soaps. And, I mean, she's got stories of actresses trying to trip each other up and just being terrible. And, you know, I think that's it's just all a function of ego that you just don't get to have. I mean, if you've got an ego, you really don't last in our end of the business.
Yeah.
In our little corner, the voiceover corner, people that come in there with huge, you know, entitlement and you know, self-love, self-servingness, just they don't get very far.
Yeah, it's Mo said it beautifully. I don't think that we know anybody who's so talented that they can be a complete jerk. and also, when you do know people like Frank, Tress, McNeil, Jess, you know, Billy West, D. Bradley Baker, on and on and on. They are so freaking talented and utterly devoid of pretense. And then you get to work with a guy like Steven Spielberg and you see how he moves through his life and he could behave any way he wants. And he chooses to be a really decent guy. And so there
Steven,
really is no
Steven
excuse.
Makes you feel like you're the only person in the room.
Yep.
When we're talking to him. He's not, he has none of that, you know, looking around, see if anybody more important walked into the party. It's like he is with you and he is talking right to you and he remembers. He remembers conversation from 2 years ago. He just picks up where he left off.
Really something.
Amazing guy. An amazing brain inside that man.
So, when you talk about Steven Spielberg as being producer on the show, you know, a lot of people think, all right, you know, producer, maybe he's putting his name on it and he's maybe he'll have a word or two, but he's just sitting back and collecting a check for this. But you make it sound like that he was very hands-on with the show.
Wellesley will tell us, you know, Stephen loved this script. Stephen loves the look of the show. Stephen sees every script. Stephen signs off on absolutely everything. You know, Wellesley is running the show in the sense that the day-to-day of it, and, you know, certainly he's got a great sense of comedy. Wellesley's our show runner. He's the captain. Stephen's the admiral. But Stephen is definitely hands-on and it's happening without his approval.
And, Corey, the reboot was never going to happen, unless Steven Spielberg and Sam Register, president of Warner Brothers Animation, decided it was going to. But moreover, it was never going to happen, according to Steven, unless Maurice, Tress, Jess, and yours truly were in. It's not about having, you know, as Maurice says often, Peter Dinklage as the brain and Russell Brand as Pinky. And it's, you know, we're fans of both of those fine actors, but it's not about having a celebrity. It's about authenticity. And this was Mr. Spielberg's call long before any deals were done. And you mentioned, you know, puts his name on it and collects the check. Obviously, he is a brand, but he doesn't need to collect the check. It's not about the money at that level.
Yeah.
It's about what, you know, another way to bring joy to millions, and ain't nobody knows how to do it better than Mr. Spielberg.
Yeah, he really is a craftsman, a storyteller. He's
you know, and that's great to hear, because I've always wondered, you know, because it's varying involvements for producers on things. It's great to hear that he's at heart, he's still a creative, you know, that's amazing.
Oh, yeah.
I think that's part of his DNA. I mean, that's all he does.
Yeah. You know, going back to your comedy, Maurice, and this is going to lead to a question for both of you. And like I said, Rob, you know, we're having a lot of fun. You came in at a great time, and I don't want to bring everything down, but I will say this, Maurice, I remember back in 85, man, you were definitely making a name for yourself in comedy. I remember a commercial that you did at the time Fuji videotape.
I remember those so clearly, and it was before I met Maurice, and I was just blown away. Oh my God! No, he's the real deal. I'm so glad you brought that up, Corey.
Yeah, you know what? I'm going to show people. I was showing people a little bit of it while you guys were talking. I'm going to show you how he brought these talents to the commercial. Again, for his rapid fire impressions. And this is a commercial, and he does so many during this time. Here's the commercial right here.
They forward and reverse it hundreds of times. Meep, 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 meep. I'm giving it full power, and she's still holding together. That's a demanding job.
Amazing.
How about that?
I remember when I'm old enough to remember when that came on and when it aired at the time. And that is such an, again, an incredible thing to kind of come back around and talk to you about that. You know, you at the time your career was up and coming in comedy. And here's where I'm going to bring in bring the interview down a little bit. But you had some tragedies in your life, Maurice. You had your father was shot by a friend at one time, and then not too long after you lost
my baby sister, who was she was born when I was 14 years old from my dad's second marriage. She was one of those angels on earth, just the sweetest, kindest human being you could ever meet. She died at 18. She wasn't wearing her seatbelt, and there was just a little moment of distraction as she was playing with the radio, and went over onto the gravel on a country road and flipped the car. But yeah, those two tragedies kind of knocked me off my comedy perch for a little while, you know, and I just really couldn't see myself making people laugh while I was in such pain. And I did turn to drugs and alcohol to kind of, treat that pain, and it was not the right treatment. If only I'd known talking about it and accepting hugs and having good friends, was the answer. But I thought that, as I said, a bottle of vodka every other day, you know, was kind of the answer. And it wasn't. And it took me out. It's funny with comedy. It's like falling off a bike and not getting back on it for 3 years. Suddenly you have a phobia about bikes. I could never quite get back. All of a sudden getting on stage and telling people, jokes and humorous stories and putting on skits became this terrifying thing to me, the way it is to 99% of the world.
Yeah.
Lost my rhythm with it. So stand-up comedy was a path that I was on, and I still occasionally wonder, what would have happened if, but those thoughts are kind of useless. I'm grateful for the life I've got. And, when Rob and I get to go on the road and do shtick, either at a Comic-Con or, and I hope those days come back to us in the next, couple of years, where we, do the Animaniacs live show, mm-hmm. or a Comic-Con where we literally just riff in front of a room of 2,000 people, we've got the acceptance of the audience already because they love Pinky and the Brain, and they know that those are our secret identities. So, we can go out there and we can just, I hate the word improv. Improv scares the living daylights out of me. I call it messing around with my best friend on stage with me. Who's
it works for me, baby.
Anything, if I'm with Rob Paulsen, I'm fearless on stage. That's, I guess, the secret of improv, except I only have one improv player I feel safe to do it with, and that's Rob. So I'm just effing around with my pal. And we can do anything,
It's the truth. It really is. It's like a superpower. I think people have said for years, and we both accept the generous compliment in the spirit in which it's delivered, and they'll say, my God, Pinky and the Brain is one of the great comedy duos of all time. And I think that's probably not hyperbole, but understanding that Mo and I know that it's the characters. We don't draw them. We don't write them. I'm telling you what. When we're together like that, it is effortless. And we really do know how each other move and what we're going to say and what we're going to think. And the truth is we're having more fun than anybody else. Yeah. It's fantastic.
But that comedy duo thing, it's a compliment that I can only accept 1/87th of. There's terrific writers behind that great comedy duo.
Yeah.
There's incredible artists. There's fabulous music. I mean, there's just so much that comes together to make Animaniacs and Pinky and the Brain what it is,
mm-hmm.
both previous iteration and its current, wonderful, wonderful incarnation you're going to see tomorrow.
Yeah.
We're very proud of it, but the voice performances are important, but it's just a piece of it. So we are thrilled to be. I speak for both of us. I know. My friend, Mr. Paulsen, knows the meaning of the word gratitude. We are so lucky to have jumped on board this thing and to have been accepted.
Unbelievable.
If I may ask, you guys, it's such a joy to hear about your friendship, and you're so happy when you're doing these voices. I can see that. And, you know, and you, when you're doing these characters, you know, these are usually comical characters that you're doing. But as I said, you both had some hardships. Maurice, we talked about yours. Of course, you know, Rob Paulsen, everybody knows about, you know, the cancer that you had. You know, how do you, you know, what, how do you keep your spirits up when you're doing these voices? And also, and this is again for both of you, is there any part of those hardships that you bring to these performances, even though these are mostly humorous characters?
Well, Maurice, I think, you know, one as an actor, one's instrument is informed by everything that's ever happened to them. So, you know, there's a depth that comes to the, you know, even though we're doing comedy, there's a depth that comes to the performances, I think, and 'cause comedy is for dealing with tragedy. I mean, we laugh so we won't cry. That's a mechanism that whatever power that runs the universe installed in us, so we don't lose our freaking minds. So the idea that, you know, some things have happened to us, it just attunes us more to the great comedy and tragedy of life, you know. And so I think I'm a better comedian than I was 27 years ago. I think I know my way around a pause, or an arched eyebrow, or just delivering a funny line. And I feel Mr. Paulsen, my esteemed colleague across the aisle, across the lot. And someone's pissed at you, man. I heard, burp. Hey, move. Burp.
Yeah, are you stuck in traffic right now doing this interview?
I got to go up and paint Hearst Castle.
Burp. That's right. Got to make a living. No, Mo's obviously correct. And I think in my case, tragedy is not even in the playbook here. What Maurice has endured, and others who know what it's like to have, I mean, it's really difficult to quantify. Nobody gets out of here without a couple of dings, Corey. Maurice has had way more than a fender bender. You know, I had throat cancer. It was very difficult. But that is the sort of thing that sadly a lot of people have to deal with. However, what happens when one goes through, deals with astonishing grief in Mo's case, and comes through it on the other side, is that you have this sense of empathy that you never would have had were it not for these impossibly difficult circumstances. And so now, when I say to somebody, oh man, I totally get it. I really do. I know what they're going through. It allows me to be a better person. It allows me to be a more empathic, thoughtful individual. And both Mo and I, regardless of the tragedies, like I said, in my case, it was a tap dance with cancer. Very difficult, but not a tragedy. It enables us to, especially nice people like you, Corey, to the extent that folks make a fuss over us, we never know when somebody's going to be watching a show that you've done with Mo and me and our stories, Mo's story about how he got through that and is back at the very top of his game, better than he was before, with Mr. Spielberg again. It is a wonderfully inspirational thing for people to see that.
But I have to say, and you too, yes, your cancer was a challenge.
Yes.
Challenge, if it had beaten you, if it had gotten you,
that's a tragedy, been. Yeah.
But what you do now is you help people. And these things each are an opportunity for you to bring more experience to helping other people. I've talked and worked with people who've had murder in their lives.
Right.
Rob helps cancer survivors. You're the spokesman now for head and neck.
Correct.
For Michael Douglas for Head and Neck Cancer Association. We're both made stronger by our challenges.
Yep.
If we don't take them and put them back out of the world, take what we've learned to help our brothers and sisters in the human family,
Right.
And that I, in my opinion, shame on me. So
absolutely. And Mo and I absolutely are cut from the same cloth. And I think that's why we love each other. But he's right. And what he won't tell you, of course, is AA is anonymous for a reason. But I don't even know how to tell you how many times I've been with Mo on the road. I say, Robbie, hang on a second. I'll meet you downstairs for dinner in a bit. I gotta call a young man or young woman who's who needs a sponsor. I'll take care of it. But I mean, Mo would be the first to tell you. Of course he does. A lot of people do, because that's what they do. And the truth is that after you go through something that is a deep challenge or a deep tragedy, it gives you a privilege. It is nothing short of a privilege to be in a position in which you can make a difference in someone's life. It's not about a paycheck. We've both been rich. We've both been poor. Rich is better. But the opportunity.
One of us is all the way back to poor, by the way.
Yeah. But the opportunity.
The pandemic. What the hell was I thinking?
Going on. You know, but the opportunity to make a difference in someone's life over and above playing in Hollywood with Steven Spielberg and Sam Register and Wellesley Wild and Gabe Swire and Julie and Steve Bernstein, all these world-class talents. That's our job. But the responsibility of being a human is different. And it's something we can all do. You don't have to be famous, sort of famous, quasi-famous, infamous. It's about being a decent human. And and so, like Mo said, shame on us if we don't do that.
Just go help somebody. That's it. That's the message. You know, you feel when you're feeling down, when you're feeling that, you know, the world's again, go help someone else. And so go do something for someone. Call a friend who's depressed and say, how you doing? So call somebody in the hospital, you know, and say, how you feeling? Or this recovering. It's amazing how you get out of yourself. And that's not just for recovering alcoholics.
No.
Everybody, you know?
You know, I got to tell you, this started out very fun. Got emotional a little bit. And everybody talks about how they love your work. They love the characters that you do. But at the end of this, this became so influential to a lot of people. A lot of people looking at this and they said, man, this got so positively deep at the end. And people have, I've seen people in the chat talking about they're crying at the friendship they see going on right now with you two. You're bringing me on the verge of tears almost. I could spend all day talking.
Well, that's you know what that is, Corey? That's because there's nothing sadder than two old men trying to be relevant. That's why.
Hey, well, make room for one more, man. I'm almost 50, so, you know.
You're almost 50.
Oh, I'd give everything to be 50 again.
Mo and I were the entertainment at the Last Supper. So hey, I know about
it. Jesus, I'm all right now, but last week I was in rough shape, you know. Judas over here. Hey.
Hey, I'll tell you. No, I really do have to go because I got to go back to the store here and talk to this guy. But
you got to go.
I love Maurice LaMarche. Period. End of story.
Let me just put it this. Let me just say one last thing. Pinky, are you pondering what I'm pondering?
Well, I think so, Brain. But if Jack's black and Betty's white, is Marvin gay?
Nerve.
Why not?
That's funny. That's funny.
Thank you.
Well, it's funny, ladies and gentlemen.
I love you, buddy. I'll talk to you soon.
My friend.
Corey, thank you very much, pal. I really appreciate this opportunity, and you allowed me to co-opt Maurice's time, and that was very sweet of you both.
We're always better together.
Always. So thank you, Corey, and so thank your audience. Thanks. Thank you guys all so much.
Thank you for getting
us to this part, and I hope you, as they say, have as much fun watching it as we had making it, because it really is that simple. It's mind-blowingly fun. So, one last thing.
Nerve!
Oh, this has been great. This has been great. I was going to say with you guys, man, I was going to leave on that positive note right there. You know, that was so, that's a great way to just kind of close things right here. Like, 'cause I could talk to you all day, but that was a great way to, like, just, you know, leave people people are they're walking away feeling inspired from you too, not just laughing at with you and, you know, and having fun, but they feel truly inspired by the conversation that you just gave them. And I want to thank you for that. Like I said, this was more than an interview. I don't speak alone on this. This was a real gift right here, and I thank you for that.
Well, thank you, Corey. Thanks for having me, man. It's been great. Thanks for letting me get talk about stuff that I don't normally get to talk about, you know, because it is important. It's important we're there for each other. We're only here for a little while. So,
well, pleasure has been all mine. People, Mr. Maurice LaMarche, watch The Animaniacs coming up on Hulu this weekend. Of course, look for Pinky and the Brain. And I was so happy to have both Pinky and the Brain himself here with me today. Thank you, Maurice.
Thank you, Corey. Thanks for having me.
You have a good one. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Oh, man. I'm going to have to get my composure. Oh, whoa, oh, my God. You know, people, that was making me teary-eyed for so many different reasons. This is a part of history right here that you just witnessed. This is, I'm going to put the chat up so you guys can see before we leave. If that can happen. When I say history, you know, as they said, Pinky and the Brain, they are one of the greatest comedy duos ever. Hands down. That's no argument. And both these men are legends in themselves for everything that they've done. I hope you enjoyed this as much as I have. I hope you've cherished this as much as I have. A lot of history right there. And a lot of tenderness and a lot of love was in there too. You can ask people a lot of questions and they can answer all day. And they can give you all the things that you know and love them for. But to see two men come in and share these intimate moments and depart with such good wisdom, you can't ask for more than that in an interview. You really can't. Thank you guys so much for being here. I'm going to leave quickly because I'm going to go off in a corner and cry. But I want to thank the chat for being here. And chat, let me bring you up real quick. I know you guys are here and I see you, and I should have brought you up so that you could have seen yourself. I want to thank all of you for being here today. Reading your comments as I did this, and the comments will flow in a little bit. I had to pull this up, so it's a little sparse right now. But reading your comments and your reactions to what you heard right here was just encouraging me more and giving me a lot of inspiration as I was talking to these two gentlemen. So thank you, guys. Thank you so much, man. As I said, I hope that you had a really good time with this. I know I did. This is something that makes me want to continue to do interviews. So I'll be putting this up later. If you missed it or you just got it on the tail end of it, you can watch this on the VOD. And people, that was amazing. No peanuts this time. No. No. It's moments like this that I live for, man. I really do. I really do. It's one of the things that I walk away from. And you guys really have given me a moment in my life, man. You've given me a life. I don't know what's wrong, man. I'm about to start crying. I got to go, man. Thank you guys so much. Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate it. And as I always say, we'll see you on the next one, whatever that may be. kcoolmans@gmail.com. Email us. I told you, even when I'm not streaming, I'm still here for you. Talk to me. Hit me up with any kind of questions, comments, compliments, insults, input, and our advice. And get a hold of me on the social medias, Instagram, Twitter, and the Facebook. Copy those or that information down right there. Memorize it. Love it. Use it. And whenever you can find yourself back here in Austin, Texas, and I don't know when, but when you do find yourself here, I want it to be safe. So let's wait for that time to happen. Meanwhile, go ahead and let me know what your plans are for Austin when you can't get around to it. kcoolmans@gmail.com. Let me know if you're going to be moving here to lovely Austin, Texas, or just passing through. We once again want to safely hang out with you. All right, everybody. That was great. Nothing more I can say can top what happened a few minutes ago or for that hour that we had. So I will just say good night, good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Whenever you are listening to or watching this, goodbye and stay toasty.